Welcome to the 12th meeting of 2024 and Session 6 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. We have no apologies today. We will consider a total of four affirmative instruments today. Our first agenda item is consideration of the first two instruments, the Draft Equality Act 2010, Specification of Public Authorities Scotland Order 2024, and the Draft Equality Act 2010, Specific Duties Scotland Amendment Regulations 2024. I welcome to the meeting Siobhan Brown, Minister for Victims and Community Safety, Jenny Hunt, Senior Policy Manager, Safety, Openness and Learning Legislation Team, Rachel Innes, Community Interventions Team Leader, Community Justice Division, and Jordan McGrory, Solicitor, Legal Directorate, Scottish Government. I refer members to Paper 1 and invite the Minister to speak to the draft instruments.
Good morning, Convener, and good morning to the Committee. The two SSIs you are considering today are routine and concern the application of the public sector equality duty and the Scottish specific equality duties to two public authorities, Community Justice Scotland and the Patient Safety Commissioner for Scotland. The Office of the Patient Safety Commissioner for Scotland was established by legislation which was passed by Parliament in September last year and came into effect at the start of this month. The legislation was introduced in response to a recommendation of the Independent Medicines and Medical Devices Safety Review. This review followed a number of high-profile instances in which patients raised concerns about the safety of medical interventions which were not heeded by healthcare professionals, resulting in harm. The Commissioner will be an independent public advocate for patients on issues of safety. They will champion the value of listening to patients and holding organisations to account for their responsibility to take patients' concerns seriously. They will bring together evidence of patients' experiences and concerns with wider patient safety data, using this to identify potential systemic patient safety issues. They will have powers to require information from healthcare organisations and to investigate patient safety concerns where they feel there is a need. I understand that the Parliament is currently in the process of recruiting the first Commissioner. Community Justice Scotland is a national body for community justice in Scotland and was established in April 2017 when the new model for community justice was introduced. Community Justice Scotland's aims is to promote and advance the national strategy for community justice in order to create a more robust and effective community justice system based on local planning and delivery by a range of statutory and other partners supported and guided by national leadership and oversight. It also monitors, promotes and supports improvement in performance in the provision of community justice across Scotland. The Equality Act 2010, Specification of Public Authorities Scotland Order 2024, will add Community Justice Scotland and the Patient Safety Commissioner for Scotland to the list of public authorities required to comply with the public sector equality duty. This duty requires public authorities, when exercising their functions, to have due regard to the need to eliminate discrimination, harassment and victimisation, the need to advance equality of opportunity and the need to foster good relations between persons who share protected characteristics and persons who do not. The Equality Act 2010 Specific Duties Scotland Amendment Regulations 2024 will apply the Scottish specific equality duties by adding the bodies to the Equality Act 2010 Specific Duties Scotland Regulation 2012. These will require Community Justice Scotland and the Patient Safety Commissioner for Scotland to, for example, publish equality outcomes and report on progress towards achieving these outcomes, report on mainstreaming equality, and publish information on the gender pay gap and equal pay. With regard to the Community Justice Scotland, it is worth noting that while the organisation has existed for a number of years, equality legislation was not updated when it was first established. The Equality and Human Rights Commission subsequently recommended that appropriate changes be made to include Community Justice Scotland. The Scottish Government agrees with that recommendation, and this legislation will ensure Community Justice Scotland is fully subject to the provisions therein. The committee may wish to note, however, that up to this point, Community Justice Scotland has considered itself to be under the general public sector equality duty from the outset, and it has acted accordingly. In summary, I recognise the importance of ensuring that in exercising any functions, our public authorities do so with regard to the equality duties, and I consider these SSIs to be the best approach to ensure that that happens. I hope that provides a useful overview, and I'm happy to take any questions that the committee may have, convener. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. Do members have any questions? Maggie.
Thanks very much, Karen, and good morning, Minister. Thank you for being here this morning. Just it's really reassurance. In your remarks, you talked about what the public sector equality duties are and what these organisations need to do, and one is foster good relations. Are you confident that both of these organisations have the resources that they need to actually meet those obligations under the Equality Act? And because obviously some of the specific ones that you mentioned are around data gathering, and something like fostering good relations is a little bit different. It's of a different category to data gathering. And I just wondered whether you were confident that there was sufficient resource and awareness of what was needed for that specific one on fostering good relations.
Thank you, convener. Yes, it hasn't been raised that there are any issues or financial complications regarding that. And I know there's the Community Justice Scotland, even though they haven't needed to demonstrate up until now to this SSI, they have been doing that in the meantime since 2017 when it was established. I don't know if there's any officials that have any insight to any concerns that have been raised.
No. As the Minister says, CGS has to date already considered itself to be under that duty, and we are engaging with them to ensure that they are ready to report and their board and management are content with the legislation that we're taking forward and are ready to report against the Scottish-specific duties.
Thank you. That's helpful. Thank
you. Any members have any more questions? So no members of the committee have indicated that they wish to ask any more questions or make any more comments. So we will now move on to agenda item two, straight to item two, which is the formal business in relation to the instruments. I invite the Minister to move the motions S6M12908 and S6M12909.
Formally move, convener.
Thank you. Do members have any other final comments? If not, are we all agreed? We are agreed. I invite the committee to agree to delegate to me the publication of a short factual report on our deliberations of the affirmative SSIs that we have considered today. Are we all agreed? That completes consideration of the first two affirmative instruments, and we will suspend briefly to change over officials. Our third agenda item is consideration of the affirmative instrument, the Draft Scottish Tribunals Listed Tribunals Regulations 2024. I welcome back to the meeting Minister Siobhan Brown, who is now accompanied by the officials Lisa Davidson, Tribunal's Policy Team Leader, and Natalie Milligan, Solicitor, Legal Directorate, Scottish Government. Again, I refer members to Paper 1, and I invite the Minister to speak to the draft instrument.
Thank you, Convener. These are the draft Scottish Tribunals, Listed Tribunals, Regulations 2024. These relatively straightforward regulations amend the Tribunals Scotland Act 2014 to include the Transport Tribunal in the list of tribunals listed at Schedule 1 of that Act, whose functions may then be transferred to the Scottish Tribunals. These regulations also specify the appeal functions for the Transport Tribunal, which may be transferred, namely the devolved appeals function. The Tribunals Scotland Act 2014 created a new simplified statutory framework for tribunals in Scotland by establishing the First Tier Tribunal for Scotland and the Upper Tribunal for Scotland, known collectively as the Scottish Tribunals. The Act brought existing tribunal jurisdictions together and provided a structure for new jurisdictions. Schedule 1 of the Act sets out those bodies whose functions may transfer into the Scottish Tribunals. These draft regulations are part of a wider suite of regulations required to transfer certain appeal functions of the Transport Tribunal under Section 39 of the Transport Scotland Act 2001 to the Upper Tribunal for Scotland, and to allocate new appeal functions in relation to bus services improvements partnerships under the Transport Scotland Act 2019 to the Upper Tribunal for Scotland. It is intended that the respective transfer and allocation of these appeals functions to the Upper Tribunal occur at the same time, and the Scottish Government is currently working towards a transfer and allocation date in December 2024. Further regulations to affect this transfer and allocations will follow. The Scottish Tribunals Listed Tribunals Regulations 2024 support the Scottish Government's policy intention to transfer devolved appeal functions into Scottish Tribunals. Finally, I understand that the DPLR Committee considered these draft regulations on the 23rd of April and there were no points that were raised. I am happy to answer any questions, Convener.
Thank you, Minister. Do members have any questions in relation to this? Nope, I don't. So no member of the committee has indicated that they wish to ask any questions or make any comments. So we'll move straight to agenda item 4, which is consideration of the motion for approval for the affirmative instrument. I invite the minister to move the motion S6M12847.
Formally moved, Convener.
Thank you. Do members have any final comments? Are we all agreed? I invite the committee to agree to delegate to me the publication of a short factual report on our deliberations of the affirmative SSI that we have considered today. Are we all agreed? That completes consideration of the affirmative instrument. We will suspend briefly to change over officials. Our fifth agenda item is consideration of affirmative instrument, the draft damages review of rate of return Scotland Regulations 2024. I welcome back to the meeting Minister Siobhan Brown, who is now accompanied by officials Michael Paparakis, Policy and Bill Programme Manager, Private Law Unit, and Scott Matheson, Senior Principal Legal Officer, Legal Directorate, Scottish Government. Again, I refer members to Paper 1 and invite the Minister to speak to the draft instrument.
Thank you, Convener. The personal injury discount rate is the rate by which an award of damages for personal injury, which includes future loss in the form of a lump sum, is adjusted to reflect the fact that the injured person can invest the money. The way in which the discount rate is calculated was reformed in 2019 by the Damages, Investment Returns and Periodical Payments Act. Under that legislation, the current discount rate is -0.75%. The legislation requires a statutory review of the rate every 5 years, and a review is therefore required to begin on the 1st of July 2024 and be completed within 90 days. Ahead of the review, the Scottish ministers must consider whether the factors to be used in the review continue to meet the needs of the hypothetical investor. That consideration is now complete, and these regulations amend some of the factors that the government actuary must use in reviewing the personal injury discount rate. The factors which are being amended are: the index for impact on inflation will change from RPI to the average weekly earnings index, and the standard adjustment for tax and costs will change from 0.75% to 1.25%. and the period of investment will change from 30 years to 43 years. These amendments have been informed both by consultation carried out last year with stakeholders and work that we've commissioned jointly with the Northern Ireland Executive in a form of a report from the Government Actuaries Department. I'm happy to take any questions, Convener.
Thank you, Minister. Do we have any questions? Megan.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning, Minister. In relation to evidence, in relation to the increase from 0.75 to 1.25, can I just ask what the evidence behind that change, if you've got anything to back up the decision that the government's wanting to take?
Yes, sure. In May last year, the Scottish Government invited views on the need or otherwise to adjust any of the statutory factors and requested any evidence to support these views. In addition, we invited views and evidence on whether a single or multiple rate should apply, and a total of 24 responses were received, including from all the key stakeholders. The Scottish Government has asked GAD to consider these responses and other available evidence to provide advice to the Scottish Government, and the consultation was carried out, as I said in my opening speech, in consultation with the Northern Ireland Executive. But I might bring in Michael regarding any further evidence.
So on the specific point about the increase, the 0.5% increase, the Government Actuary Department has set that out in its review, and in essence its view is that there has been an increase in the tax drag by 0.5% from when the rate was last set in 2019 to where we are just now. So accordingly, the Scottish Government have taken the view that the current 0.75% should move by 0.5% to 1.25.
Okay. Thank you. The Minister mentioned the Northern Ireland Executive there. It is my understanding that they paused to collate more evidence on this matter. Has there been any further correspondence with them directly? And are they now moving forward with this? Or is it just the case that Scotland would be an outlier?
No, I think at the moment, from my understanding as well, they've asked for more information for the committee. But I might bring Michael in, who's corresponding with them.
As I understand it, it's questions they've asked for, not for a pause on the review. The Northern Ireland Executive have a different procedure for statutory instruments to us. So the committee have asked for more information, which I understand officials in Northern Ireland will be passing on to them, not a pause in the review as such.
Sorry, I meant a pause until further information was collated, so apologies, that's how I worded that. In terms of implications, because I think that there could be an implication certainly on our NHS, for example, should this go through. And I'm just wondering from the Minister if she could give us a bit of a further explanation in terms of what direct consequences or unintended consequences could this have on the functionality of our NHS. I'm talking about, operations, cost of operations, and all the major instrumental things that need to happen going through our NHS.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you. It's right that the defender, whoever they are, meets the cost of the award. Injury that is a catastrophic injury, regardless of whether the defender is a business or publicly funded. It's important where the pursuers are not properly compensated and they face a prospect of their money running out, that they will inevitably have to fall back on the NHS and other public social and care services, placing a burden on these services during their lifetime. And this surely cannot be the right outcome. The impact of the discount rate can, of course, be mitigated by the use of periodical payment orders, and we are working to ensure that these provisions come into force so that the courts in Scotland may, for the first time, impose a periodical payment order. And this would be helpful for bodies such as the NHS, who could be deemed to secure funding for the purposes of these provisions relating to periodical payment orders. I don't know if Michael or Scott have anything further to add to that.
I'm happy to come in. So the obviously, as the Minister has said, periodical payment orders are there to sort of offset some of the potential difficulties or with a lump sum award. And we are working with the Scottish Civil Justice Council to try and set up court rules to bring that part of the Act in into force. And equally, it's perhaps helpful to point out that the rate hasn't been set yet. So what we are doing with this SSI is to set the parameters. It's the government actuary that will then set that rate. So we don't know what will happen with the rate. We don't know if it will go up or if it will potentially go down. That's something that comes afterwards. So it's difficult to quantify what potential impact it could have.
Thank you. And if I may, just two further questions, Convener, sorry. In relation to concerns that have been raised about this, the parameter in terms of the rate, does the Minister understand that the changes could lead to some individuals being what's determined as overcompensated? And is the Minister aware of anyone ever being undercompensated up until this point through the previous rate?
Okay, thank you. The GAD analysis suggests that the current further margin at 0.5% remains applicable, and it's probably worth reiterating that the margin of 0.5% broadly results in broadly a 30 to 35% chance of undercompensation. It is impossible to ensure that no one in receipt of damages to which the discount rate applies will ever be under or overcompensated, but we can reduce the likelihood of pursuers being undercompensated through this important protection on the further margin. I don't know historically, I think it's a very fine balance between overcompensation and undercompensation that it's very hard to determine specifically, but I think Michael, if there's anything that you wanted to add to that.
Not much further I can say. I mean, yeah. Whether someone's undercompensated or overcompensated will ultimately depend on individual circumstances in a case. What we have here is with the personal injury discount rate is a sort of a one size to fit all cases. There's if we were to, for instance, suit a personal injury discount rate to the circumstances of each individual case, that would be significantly more complex than, the approach that we've taken, or this part the Parliament took in 2019 with the Act. Sorry.
And then final question is in relation to insurance bills. Is there a risk that insurance bills could increase as a result of this decision? For example, motorists, other premiums, could it have an impact on the wider public?
We'll bring in, I think we've seen an increase in all insurance premiums that since the cost of living crisis. I think every household's been impacted, but I don't know specifically if this will increase insurance premiums. Michael?
I guess ultimately it will be for those companies to decide how they will act. As I said, the rate hasn't been set yet, it could increase as much as it could decrease. That would be for the government actually to determine, and ultimately the insurance companies will decide if they want to pass costs on or if there's any cost to pass on. They'll set their own premiums themselves.
Okay, thank you, Kavira.
Thank you. Any other questions from members? No other members have indicated that they want to ask any questions or make any more comments. So we'll move on to agenda item 6, which is consideration of the motion for approval for the affirmative instrument. And I invite the Minister to move the motion S6M12994.
Formally moved, Convener.
Thank you. Do members have any final comments? Megan?
In terms of the Northern Ireland Executive Convener, I'm just wondering if it would be appropriate for us to perhaps fall in line with the more information that they're seeking and perhaps ask for more information ourselves on this matter before proceeding.
OK, do you want to formally suggest that? Do you want
Yes.
to put this to a vote?
Yes, please.
OK, thank you. We will move to a vote. So do any of the members, so there is a disagreement, so we are not agreed, therefore there will be a division on this. So the question is whether motion S6M12994 is agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Yep. Okay, members are not all agreed. So I will ask the members in turn whether you vote yes, no, or abstain. So members voting yes for the motion.
And me. Of course.
We've got everybody. And members against. I think that's everyone, but is there any abstentions? Just in case. No. So that was 5 votes for, 2 against. So the motion is passed. So I invite the committee to agree to delegate to me the publication of a short factual report on our deliberations on the affirmative SSI that we have considered today. Okay. We could still write to the government, Megan, if you would like to set out your questions and what happened today.
Just to get more information, certainly
Absolutely.
Not against the principle of it. It's just to get more information as to what the consequences or unintended consequences could be.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so that completes consideration of the affirmative instrument, and I'd like to thank the Minister and all our officials for their attendance today. Thank you. Now we move on. That concludes our formal business for today's meeting. We will now move into our private session.